Hey Rebs, Jared Ivey here. Welcome back to Ivey League. This week I'm here with my road dog, Tracey Ivey. How you doing, Mom?
I'm great. How are you, Jared?
I'm doing fantastic. Good. Happy Mother's Day.
Thank you. Yeah. I love you so much.
So a quick rundown, a little backstory. Where are you from?
I'm originally from Brooklyn, New York, by way of Houston, Texas. We moved there when we were 12, going on 13. So I've actually been, lived in Georgia longer than I lived in Texas. Mm.
So where'd you like more? You like being in Brooklyn or you like being in Houston more?
Well, because I've been in Houston longer, I mean, we didn't get to do too much.
You did more the fun years.
In Texas, yes, because when we were in New York, you know, Grandma, we had to have somebody watch us outside. Like, we couldn't just go outside and play. Mm-hmm. We had to have somebody outside watching us until we got to a certain age. Like, when we go back for the summers, like, Auntie Sharon would be at work, and then we could hang out outside, you know, with the regular kids, you know, that was fun. But what was funny, when we would go back to visit our friends, they would ask us if we rode a horse to school. Mm, no. We're like, no, we walked school bus.
But I also think that something that plays a role into that is kind of just being like that first generation of immigrants and stuff like, and kind of them being immigrants and not really fully being comfortable. Like, what was it like growing up Black, but, you know, still Jamaican at the same time, you know?
There's so many cultures in Brooklyn. So we grew up with Haitians and Puerto Ricans and Dominicans and Jamaicans. So it was like a truly a melting pot. And that's why Uncle Billy's name is Bushwick Bill, because we lived in Bushwick. Of Brooklyn.
Yeah.
You know, Irvin Avenue and Putnam and Irvin Avenue. Shout out.
Oh, shout out. I still haven't been up there, so.
No. When we went, to New York with your dad, when we went to go see the Color Purple, I remember calling Grandma in front of the brownstone saying, "Hey, Grandma, we're in front of the brownstone." Mm. She said, "Fine, you see it, leave."
Oh.
We're like, okay.
What's wrong with the brownstone?
Nothing was wrong. It was just a neighborhood.
Yeah.
Like, so she was a really big catalyst of us moving to Texas because she could see the neighborhood getting rough. Mm-hmm. And we went to Catholic school, so we walked the 10 or 12 blocks to Catholic school, but we were going to get to the age where, like, high school was going to come up and we would have to, like, take the train and do stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And she just wasn't comfortable. And she, you know, told Mimi that, you know, we should, you know, go ahead and just move permanently to Texas. So that's what we did.
So you guys moved to Texas. What was it like growing up in Houston in the 80s? What was the 80s like?
The 80s?
Why is that, like, that's such a big pause?
Well, the 80s and 90s were fun. They were fun. It was like that. It was that, you know, Mimi worked a whole lot. So, but we had like a healthy fear of Mimi. Mm. So, like, we probably could have been, excuse my friendship, like the biggest wild girls out there. But we just knew that she
Super
wasn't
explicit.
Having that. And we just knew that she had eyes in the back of her head. So we just didn't do it. Mm. We were just good girls.
Did you ever wear leg warmers?
I did. I wore leg warmers in the 80s in Brooklyn. Oh. And because we wore uniforms, that was the only way we could be different. We had our leg warmers. We had our Madonna plastic.
With the uniform on.
Yes. They would let us do that. We would have our lime green or lime yellow tops with our bangles, our Madonna plastic bangles. Mm. Oh, yeah. You can tell us nothing. We were cute.
All right. So, speaking of growing up in the 90s, Freaknik is coming up. And I know a lot of my friends, like a lot of my teammates from here want to go out there.
It's not going to be the same.
What was it like?
Okay. So we graduated high school in Houston, and then we went to Prairie View A&M, which is about an hour and a half outside of Houston. Mm. So Stacy had a really good friend. Well, she's both of our friends, but Stacy met her first. So Trinita lived in Atlanta. So Trinita said, "Hey, twins, let's go to Freaknik." And we're like, "What's Freaknik?" So we rented a car. I think we were all like probably 17, 18. And we drove to Atlanta. And Stacy and I got here and we were like, "What? Look at all the boys. Oh my goodness." And so then we figured out that they had our major at Clark Atlanta. We went to Freaknik. We had a great time. No, you will not find me in the documentary. No, we did not do all that on top of the cars. No, I did not do that. But we got back to Atlanta. I mean, we got back to Houston, and we told my mom, hey, we're going to transfer, and we're moving to Atlanta. And she was like, what?
So what was that like, you know, growing up with such, like, my grandma has seven siblings?
She's one of ten. Yeah, she's
but
the
seven that lived in New York and Houston.
Yes, mostly all of our family eventually migrated, except for Uncle Tony. He's still up there, but everybody came down to Houston.
Right. So being around family your entire life, like never being anywhere away from family, what was it like? You know, moving four states away and being on your own for college.
I really wasn't on my own. I had Stacy. Yeah. So we moved with our twin beds. Mm-hmm. Literally, we shared a room. We got here. Trinita had the second bedroom, and we had the bigger bedroom, and we had our twin beds. And then when Trinita moved out, then I had my room to myself for the first time. And so we had to been like 19 when we had our first room by ourselves. No, I lie. We had our first room when we lived in that duplex. But we were so used to being together that, you know, it wasn't like we didn't have family. I had Stacy.
I feel like y'all got like some twin telepathy. Like have y'all ever caught yourselves like doing the same thing? Or y'all woke up one day and walked into the living room, y'all had the same outfit on or something like that?
No. I mean, we dressed alike. But we got to the point where we did not want to wear the same colors. So we told my mom she could get us the same thing, but different colors. But I did go through the stage where I wanted to change my name because Tracy and Stacy, you know? And then we were in college and I said, well, maybe I could be Sage.
You would have changed your name to?
I had threw out Sage and they were like, that's a spice. And I was like, never mind.
That's pretty bad. Yeah, I'm glad you stuck it out with that one.
Thanks.
Sage is kind of who knows what I'd be named if you really went through with that. You know, I'd be like,
I was trying to think of a teen name, but your dad kept shooting down every teen name I threw out.
You would have named me Turmeric, huh? Time. Yeah.
Funny guy. Funny guy. No, I had some good teen names, but no. And I think I was actually watching a commercial and it was for a movie and they said, introducing Jared, la, la, la. So I said to him, I said, what about Jared? Mm-hmm. He's like, I like Jared. So we just started calling you Jared while you were percolating. And then
while I was percolating.
Percolating. Wow. And then I was trying to think of a teen name for the middle name, but we ended up on Gavin because it started with a G like his name. So it's Gavin.
I feel like y'all always say like, people would have made fun of me for my name starting with a G if it was still Jared. But people used to ask me if it was Jared with a G.
I was a stickler about making it a J. He wanted to make it a G. Literally in the hospital, he's filling out the paperwork. And I said, don't you spell that baby's name with a G. I said, don't you do it, because they're going to call him Garrett. And I'm going to have to correct them. But then your friend Jared Burney, he's a J, but they used to bring him to my car all the time in preschool. I was like, no, Jared Ivey's mine, not Jared Burney.
The primrose days. I still have got vivid memories of me and Jared in preschool.
I can't remember if it was you or your brother. One of y'all swallowed a quarter during nap time.
Sound like something I would do. I mean, the money's always on my mind.
I think it was Garrison. I think Garrison swallowed a quarter during nap time one time, yeah. And I said, what do I do? And they were like, well, just check his poop. And I was like,
let it circulate.
Yeah, I didn't check. I'm pretty sure it came. I didn't check.
It could still be in there to this day.
It could be.
Who knows?
It could be. I don't know.
All right, so Clark Atlanta. Mm-hmm. What was it like going to an HBCU? I know you went to Prairie View as well. Like, did you feel like, did you ever, you know, visit friends or anything at PWIs or just what was it like being around people that looked like you the entire time you were in college?
Well, because I went to a predominantly white high school, Different World came out at the time and we were seeing a different view of college life. Mm. So we were like, wait a second, this is what I want. Went to Prairie View, experienced that feel, went to Clark. But by the time I got to Clark, to be honest with you, I was ready to graduate. So it was pretty much go to class, go to work, go home. Mm. I didn't really We didn't do too much hanging out. Again, I was a theater minor when I was at Clark. Shout out, Clark.
MC.
blackout. so it was go to work, go to class, graduate at that point, you know. But we still had fun. We had a couple of nice parties off Buford Highway at our apartment, Tempo 2000.
You
shout
told
out.
Me, I told you told me. Tempo. So you fell asleep next to the speaker one time.
Oh, went to the Jamaican club. And it was during spring break, and I fell asleep with a Heineken in between my fingers next to a speaker.
Man.
I was tired.
How does that happen? I feel like the maybe the bass wasn't kicking like
the
that.
The bass was so loud.
The bass was kicking?
So loud.
How did you fall
asleep
to that?
So loud. I was tired. But I would only go out during like summertime and spring break because I had to work, go to school, work, go to school.
What were you doing?
I actually worked at a Payless. It was a new Payless that opened up right off Buford Highway down the street. And I remember there was a Quick Trip right next to the Payless and went in there on break. And all of a sudden somebody was like, "Twin." And I turned around. It was somebody from Houston.
No way.
Yeah. I was like, "Hey, what you doing here?"
Yeah, that's crazy. It's just somebody from high school or somebody from Prairie View?
It was somebody from Prairie View. But again, I have a really bad memory with names, so I could not remember what his name was. Of course, Stacy remembers everybody. She's like, "Don't you?" No, I don't remember. But she remembered who he was. But yeah, I opened that Payless store off Buford Highway.
I know you did retail like at a bunch of different spots for a while.
Yes.
What was it like transitioning and going up?
I love retail. I love retail until I got married and had kids. Mm. And then the hours were just...
Shoot.
The hours were
Story
just...
retail dreams away. My bad.
But no. I did. I enjoyed working retail. I really did. I met some really good... You know, I still have good friends, the Cushionberries, yeah. You know, all that stuff. But when after, you know, Dad left us, you know, they were like, "What are you going to do?" And I was like, "I can't go back to retail." I could have went back to retail, but the hours just weren't conducive.
Yeah.
And they don't really pay like they used to pay back in the day either. And then having to fold clothes... You hate going shopping with me because I always put everything back.
I do. And you always pick out the worst stuff. You're like, you think this would look good on you?
Sir.
Who would wear that?
Sir.
we stopped wearing those Walmart graphic tees in like third grade.
No, we used to go to Marshall's and you remember you went to your stage where you want only polos?
I knew you were going to say that. I knew you were going
to
say that.
Okay. All you wanted to wear was polo shirts?
I had the red, I had the pink polo guy, I had the blue, yeah.
I tried, y'all.
I was trying to get spiffy.
I tried. But yeah, retail was good. And then...
Did you ever have any crazy encounters with customers?
Oh, gosh. When I was a manager at Coach, my first winter season, Chili from TLC, her and her mom came in.
No way.
And I helped them shop for like 2 hours and they bought me a handbag. I still have that handbag. I can't give it away. It's a little suede hobo bag, but they... Back then, you could accept gifts.
Yeah.
Now they changed the policy. I think after that, like people, they kept.
They saw you get that bag, and they're like,
"I got a bag." They wanted to buy me some shoes, and I was like, "No, the bag's enough."
Oh wow! Well,
you know, the bag's enough.
Hop on that opportunity.
The bag's enough. But that was Lenox Mall, though. Lenox Mall was like the place to be in the late '90s, early 2000s, and we knew when the stars came out because everyone would be like. Like in the walkaway, and we would just stand there in the front of the store, and we're like, "Her feet hurt. Look how she's walking." You know what I'm saying? So we would—I mean, so many people used to come through the store. But I remember Chili coming in and buying me a handbag. Shout out, Chili.
Man, Lenox is a danger zone now.
Man,
we our team hotel when I was at Tech was across the street, and there's just cops every weekend.
It's different. It's not the same because I worked at the Coach in Lenox, and then across the street at Phipps Plaza. Flips was like an upper scale mall than Lenox, but it was so dead. It was boring.
It's boring.
It was so boring. You wanted people to come. You wanted somebody to come in the store, but yeah, Lenox was much more fun. But you remember you used to come, your dad used to drop you off like at the end, at night, like if I was closing, and I was like, "Don't touch anything."
Oh, maybe, I don't know.
But you used to touch everything.
That sounds like me. That I don't remember it, but I can believe that happening.
Protecting homes and businesses from the whims of nature, you need more than just quality materials. You require RiverLand Roofing. Licensed, insured, and certified, RiverLand Roofing offers not only the assurance of excellence, but a tailored approach to your unique structural needs and budget. To learn more about what RiverLand Roofing can do for you and the community, call them at 662-644-4297 or visit riverlandroofing.com.
So, you mentioned before, you know, you loved retail all the way up until you started having kids. What was, you know, the change in your life like when you first had Garrison?
Actually, I stayed home for almost 3 years after I had Garrison. I felt like that's what I was supposed to do. I was supposed to stay home. I was so bored.
Yeah, he's a boring guy.
And then when I got pregnant with you, your brother wanted me to play with him all the time. I would be late because, you know, I was on bed rest. So I could not lay in the bed. I laid on an air mattress next to the bed because the bed felt like it had rocks in it. So I'd be literally on the air mattress playing baseball, and Garrison is pitching the ball. And I'm like, I'm on the air mattress. I'm like, son, not so hard. Just don't throw the ball so hard at me. But
You were the same way with me when I first started playing baseball. Oh. And I always wanted to play catch, and you were just like, oh, I don't want to do this.
Because you were going to hit me. But you were in the outfield picking grass. Yeah. I was like, Gary, what is wrong with him? Baseball ready, Jared Ivey. Baseball ready. And you'd be like,
well,
okay.
It stuck me out there. So bad. Really bad at the beginning.
At the beginning,
It took me a year or two, and then I got right.
Yeah, but everybody, because we used to be on baseball, and all the football coaches used to always come up to me, Jared, want to play football? Jared, want to play football? I'm like, nope, he just wants to play baseball. Yeah. And they just started playing basketball.
Yeah, my first love. My first love.
Kind of lurchy when you first...
I wasn't good for a very long time.
Well, no, lurchy as in heavy feet, like
I wasn't athletic or light or quick or anything for a very long time.
And I think a lot of kids peaked early. You peaked at the right time. Yeah. Like, I think, you know, you played with a lot of different, like, AAU basketball teams. And, you did good when you went in. You know what I'm saying?
Say it like that. I still... To preface this, I was not bad.
No, he wasn't bad.
And I started on every team
year. He did.
And we were good, and I was good.
Exactly.
I wasn't
I
was in high school early on. Like, I wasn't like, oh, this kid is so promising.
No.
And he's going to become
no.
this.
No, I think because there's so many other kids that peaked early, you know, and people looking at him like, he's so tall.
Well, especially in Gwinnett. Like, I mean, it's just such a hotbed for athletes. And they start the media coverage and everything so early with Born to Compete and all these different YouTube stuff and all these rankings. And like, Josh was ranked in top 10 in the country in baseball, like in like fifth grade.
Yeah. You know, but he's still good too. So
He's still a stud.
But I'm proud of all of y'all though. Like, I see you, and then I see, like, you know, everybody, all the kids. And I'm like, God, we used to be taller than y'all. Mm-hmm. We literally used to be taller than y'all.
Not for very long.
No, I know.
Like, when did I get taller? I feel like I got taller maybe like third grade, fourth grade.
Taller than me right around then, but you were already almost as tall as both of your first grade, your kindergarten teachers.
Yeah.
Because I remember the first meeting, they were like, you know, we love Jared, but he's knocking over chairs and desks and girls. And I said, his feet are there, his arms are still.
It was hard to control.
Back there, but No. But you know me. I've always been proud of you, you know. But I am that mom that'll say, take him out the game if he's not doing what he's supposed to, you know. Mm.
Okay, so when I came into the picture, now you got two. And I not under two because we're 2.5 years apart, but two very young. What was it like dealing just with two young kids like that?
Well, y'all used to play. You remember y'all used to do the taekwondo, the karate stuff, and then y'all wanted to do Boy Scouts and the Garrison. And I was like, look, y'all have to pick because when I took the wrong person to karate that day, I knew something had to give. Mm-hmm. And I think it was Garrison's day, but I took you, and you were like, I was trying to tell you. And I was just like, get in the car, just get in the car. And it was like the wrong kid on the wrong day. And I was like, you know what? Mm-mm, can't do it. But it was a lot, but we had a really good community. So I would try to get you on a team, like when JR was on there. Mm-hmm. So, you know, my borrowed husband, Mr. Jim, could pick you up. So Mr. Jim had to, you know, shout out Jim Martin, because I could not have done it without Jim Martin.
Yeah, that's the guy. That's the guy.
Really, when I tell you, really stepped up and helped me out. But everybody stepped up and helped me out. But Jim, for real. Like, I would pick up, drop off. Like, he would pick up for me, and then I would drop, you know, I would get off work, and then I would, you know. So it was, But, Jim,
So you speak about a borrowed husband in Mr. Jim. I don't know if everybody knows, but my dad did pass away in 09 when I was 7.
Yeah.
What was that like and that experience and just, you know, becoming the only parental figure in me and Garrison's life?
It was rough. It was rough. It was unexpected. But the community really wrapped their arms around us and... It was rough, but it was good. And, you know, people wanted to know if I was going to stay in Georgia or if I was going to move back to Texas. And you and your brother said, we want to stay. We want to graduate with our friends. And so I made it work. And, you know, friends and Mimi and Stacy, Miss Yolanda, you know, everybody just, you know, helped. And we have a good tribe. Mm-hmm. We have a good tribe.
Well, you're an absolute trooper. And, you know, those names you listed off, I have a battalion of aunts.
You've got the Swanties that just know that they are all Ashley Walk Swanties and all the other Swanties are trying to come to Oxford for at least one game this season. So it's going to be fun. It's going to be fun.
I don't know if I have enough room in my apartment for that.
No. We're going to figure out an Airbnb or something like that. But you know, they're ready to come and support. And so, you know, I'm excited about that.
It was very inspiring to see you, you know, step up and just be, you know, the strong woman that you are. And, you know, I wouldn't be anywhere close to where I am now today without you. So.
I appreciate that. You know, you don't know how strong you are until you have to go through some stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember a friend asking me, well, how are you so strong? And I'm like, you're just as strong as I am. Mm-hmm. You know, you just don't know it until you need to be. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So when I needed to be, that's what I had to do. So I did what I needed to do, you know. I probably didn't do everything right, you know, but as parents, again, there's no handbook. And, you know, I think we all look back and say, I could have did that, you know, could have did that different. But, you know, you can't second guess yourself. And once you get to my golden age, you know.
Golden age? What are you? Mm-hmm. About 37, something like that.
Just celebrated 51.
Happy late one.
Again. Yeah, I was waiting for you all day.
No, what I was.
I was waiting all day for a phone call.
Over the facility all day.
And I had to call and say, hey. No, and it was really Miss Tammy came over. Miss Tammy came over. And I said, you know, Jared hasn't called me yet. And she was there for like an hour. She's like, that's not like Jared. She's like, call him right now because I'm nervous. I need to make sure Jared's okay because you know Miss Tammy. Miss Tammy was like, you got to call him. So I did. And Jared was like, oh, yeah. I knew you were busy.
I was out like a light.
No, I knew you because you said you were sleeping all day. Mm-hmm. And I was like, man. I said, Garrison called me. I was like, I'm still waiting for
him. All right, well, you're kind of drilling it now. Like, I told you every birthday. I love you. You know what I mean? Don't. I'm going to take care of you. I got something nice for you. You know what I mean? So.
Oh, I got you something?
You got me something?
Yeah. I told you I got you something for your birthday, but they keep... changing the back last December and they changed the delivery date again. Uh-huh. Supposed to get it next week, but
the phantom gift,
you're gonna like it.
I hope so. You know, God brings you through all those type of things to bring you to where you are now. And,
yeah.
And you're coming up on celebrating an anniversary, though. You did just get married. How long ago did you get married?
It'll be 2 years this year. It'll be 2 years this year.
And what month?
11/22.
Okay.
Because we were, I was actually on our first anniversary. I was on my way to Oxford because it was the bowl, the Thanksgiving bowl.
Oh, the egg bowl.
The egg bowl. We were on our way down to egg bowl. So yes. So it'll be 2 years this year. It'll be 2 years this year.
So what's it like? I know. So my mom's new husband, his name's Mujahid, and he's a Muslim.
Mm-hmm.
So what has that been like in learning more and more about his culture?
It's It's been lovely. It's been great. But again, you know, he was like, you know, I'm Muslim. I know you're Christian. It's okay. His mom's Christian still. Uh-huh. You know, he switched over being a Muslim when I think when he was in high school. So, but it's been good. His family's been good. He's got twin daughters. I'm a twin. You know, he's got twin granddaughters. Now I've got all these girls because I've had all these boys. So now I get to buy girl clothes now.
Hey, you never
so
wanted girls. You never wanted
I didn't want to be responsible for anybody's hair on a regular basis. Yeah. That was way too much responsibility.
Yeah, we had the baldies.
You did.
For very long.
You did. You remember that rough time at the barbershop you cried because the hair grew out?
I did.
I kept saying, Jared, you need to pick that hair out. You need to pick that hair out.
That was supposed to look. You didn't need to pick it out.
I didn't like that.
I had the little Duke Star 5 going. I had the little mini fro. And then,
didn't like it. And
I walked home with a baldy.
Yep. And he cried.
Eighth grade. Yeah. So one of the worst days. That next day at school. One of the worst days.
No, I thought the worst day was when I didn't let you play football. Remember?
That was tough. But I wasn't too pressed about that. But just because we had such a fun eighth grade basketball season.
But I had to stick to it, like, because I kept telling you all year, Jared, your attitude, I'm not going to let you play football. And you didn't think I was serious.
Well, I also wasn't very good. And I remember there was a lot of games where we would come home and I'd make no plays. And you would just be like, you need to decide if you really want to do this.
That wasn't eighth grade.
You were like, just in middle school, like before eighth grade, you need to decide if you really want to do this. And
well, yeah, because the money was paid. We didn't have money the money was paid. And I wasn't one of those parents where you could start something and not finish it. I remember when you played baseball, we had a couple parents, some of their kids didn't finish the season. I'm like, you already paid the money. What do you mean he's not going to finish playing the whole season? It's like, I didn't believe in that.
No.
I didn't believe you had to, if we started the season, you know, to finish the season. Uh-huh. But yeah, I know. And then they won eighth grade. But then you won the basketball. So I kind of,
We got our taste of glory.
But you do like to remind me, so it's okay.
And, but yeah, we then, you know, it was good to get back freshman year and start playing again. And then we went undefeated that year in the sophomore year, won a state championship. So
that was fun.
I feel like I didn't miss out on
that. That championship game, I remember Miss Leslie having the hand warmers on her ears, hanging out of her hat.
Yeah.
And we were freezing, and it was like everything was going in slow motion. When Josh went up, then we were like, he got the ball. Y'all, he got the ball.
He caught the ball,
you know? Mm. And then it was just, and then we won, and we're like, we weren't even freezing anymore because I physically thought my toes were going to fall off. Mm. But after y'all won,
yeah, that was a crazy one.
That was
we won very controversial. We were on like maybe somewhere around midfield, two penalties in a row on the other team, and then we won off a game-winning field goal with the time expired. So super high stakes, super emotional game, and super lit moms in the crowd drinking spiked hot chocolate. So.
I won't confirm or deny.
I won't confirm or deny that. You thought you was cool. Y'all was up there cozy in the crowd.
I think by the time the game was so long, we had already blew through all of that. You know, so we were cold again. But no. Your Swanties are out there.
Yeah, that was great. It was really cool too to stay home and go to Tech and be near y'all and have y'all be able to come to all the games.
That was fun. And that was fun because Stacy moved back from California here, and then Mimi was here, so she got to go. Even though she doesn't understand, like she's like, "Am I not going to the game?" I was like, "Look, it's not like Tech where I can drop you off at the corner.
Right.
You have to walk like a whole 5 country miles at some of these stadiums." Mm-hmm. And then when I tell her, she's like, "Oh, okay, I'll just stay with Charlotte." But she's got her, you know, every game day she's going to have her Ole Miss or whatever t-shirt on as she's watching the game at home with Charlotte. So, but it was fun being in Atlanta and having you there and having that billboard, you know, when you
that was fun.
That holographic billboard. That was nice.
It would flip through all the signees.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. So that was fun. But then I was nervous when you decided to go into the portal, and I was like, okay. And then you waited to the last weekend to do it.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
And then we came, and then you were like, "Mama, I'm going to go to Ole Miss." And I was like, okay, let me call Stacy, meet us at meet us at his dorm because we have to pack them up right now. You know, so we packed up
a very quick turnaround.
All three suitcases, and the next day it put you on a plane.
And I was enrolled by Monday.
No, you were enrolled that weekend because you were filling out paperwork.
Like, no, so I was like, I was in classes.
Yeah, you were in classes, on Monday.
Monday at workouts that Monday.
Yeah, yeah. But everybody's been so lovely here. Like, it's, it, even though it's like a 5-hour drive, we do it so often now that it's like nothing now. Because, you know, shout out Bucky's. We get to Bucky's. Bucky's is our halfway point. And then I got to get a brisket taco, you know. But everybody's been so nice, you know. And it feels like Suwannee, you know, when you're, because everywhere is like 10 minutes.
That's
to
what
get
I
to,
tell people. It's a lot. You know? It's a lot like my hometown.
But it's nice. And you know, I was nervous. I didn't know what to expect, you know, Mississippi and everything, you know. But everybody's been loving it.
It's been good. It's been good. You're a lot less, you're very active still on Twitter, but you're a lot less active than you were at Tech. My mom was almost like reaching celebrity status while I was at Tech. She wouldn't get off her phone.
Well, because I didn't like some of, I didn't like the lack of support. I felt like the fans had. They were so, I mean, every program's going to go through stuff,
right,
but they got to remember these are kids. And these kids have parents, and the parents see these comments, you know, and I read the comments now, and I'm like, people need something to do. They really need something to do because they don't even know what's going on, but they just have these assumptions, and they put this stuff out here, which bothers me to death because I know how hard y'all work. It's a lot. When you come home, all you want to do is hang out with us and go to sleep and eat. That's it.
Well, that's one of the biggest things that I have loved about being here is just the support from the community and the fan base is unbelievable.
Yes.
You know, they truly do love us, just like we love them.
And even this that you're doing, you know, this, like I was surprised when you said, Mom, I'm going to do a podcast. And, you know, Ben reached out to me and I was like, who's Ben? But okay, that's fine. And then, you know, we're in episode whatever it is now, but I'm like, you do such a great job and you're such a natural at it when I didn't even think you liked people like that. But it's, you know, I'm excited.
Thank you. I really do appreciate that.
but it's something for the fans to actually get to know the players because sometimes, you know, they're more than just y'all are more than just football players. You know what I'm saying? Y'all are whole beings and have parents and have families and do other stuff outside of playing football. That's not all you do. So I'm glad you're getting to let your teammates show that, you know, like the other interests and, you know, all that good stuff. It makes me happy.
Well, we're more than just ball players, Mom. Yes. And you're more than just my mom. You're my hero, my best friend. And I love you to death, Mom. I really appreciate you being on this week. And happy Mother's Day.
Thank you. I love you so much.
I love you too.